Hello, everybody. This is the M Crew Dude. We all remember the James Cameron film Titanic, a film about the real-life events of the Ship of Dreams, who met its tragic fate, resulting in the loss of 1,500 lives. In 1999, another tragedy struck when some Italian numbnuts decided to make an animated film about it. Get a load of this. It's a film where a mouse tells the so-called true story to his grandkids where nobody really died aboard the Titanic. I'll just give you a couple centuries for that to sink in.
On top of that, the main purpose of the film, I guess, was to be nothing more than a stupid piece of anti-whaling propaganda.
Again, let it sink in.
It gets worse, as a sequel was created for this travesty, and to think that such a thing can exist is one of the many signs that half of human society has resorted to demon worship. The title Tentacolino refers to the dog-faced octopus named Tentacles from the first movie. That studio must have been really desperate. But is Tentacolino just as bad as the film that came before it?
Well, considering the fact that it has a 1.2 out of 10 on IMDb, let's just get this over with.
So the film opens up with credits that nobody bothered to translate, as we see the main characters from the first movie, Elizabeth and Don Juan, along with their dog Smile, and mice friends Ronnie and Top Connors. One of them is supposed to be the storyteller, I think? I don't know, the first movie showed him telling the story to his grandkids, so I guess we can assume that this is just more of the same. Another thing is that I don't think any of the same voice actors reprised their roles. I wouldn't mind so much, it's just that they don't even make a token attempt to sound like the original characters.
You're right on that, my friend. Sometimes I just lose sight of the fact that not all creatures are created equal.
What? You must be joking. I'm not undergoing any treatment. No, no, absolutely not. Out of the question.
Well, there's one thing I'm not, and that's a racist.
And who are you? Some kind of psychic?
So the gang travels underwater in their yellow submarine to search for the wreckage of the Titanic when a gang of evil sharks approaches. Oh yeah, did I forget to mention that? Sharks form underwater gangs in these films. I don't have an explanation, so just deal with it.
Sharks, indeed. They're worse than cats. Ugh.
Calm down, Smile. Even cats eat mice.
What is that yellow thing, and what is it doing in my territory?
Whatever it is, I saw it first, and so I should be the one who gets the honor of telling Razor Teeth about it.
All right, you go on your own. It'll take at least a half an hour before anyone even begins to understand what you're saying.
Now, it's not nice to make fun of other shortcomings, because that's my job.
So after a phoned-in CG shot, we see one of the bad guys named Ice, but this time his name has been changed to Razor Teeth for some reason.
Yo, 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 look at my teeth. They're so sharp and white and neat. They bring on fear and heal some terror. Once they should, I make no error.
Damn it, what is it with Titanic movies and their obsession with annoying rapping animals? But would you believe me if I say that the rapping shark is even worse? Here, there's really no purpose to it. It's loud, obnoxious, and makes little sense. Not to mention the animation recycles more than a green team, and the lip sync is worse than an average PS1 video game.
Call me an assassin, terror of the sea. Yeah, the terror sea, that was me. You all know why, and that's no lie.
Moving along, the shark informs Razor Teeth about the yellow submarine, and this gives him just enough motive to destroy it.
Did you say yellow?
Yellow.
Yellow!
Yellow, yeah.
Ah, I hate that color. I can't stand yellow. Are you sure it's yellow?
Are you sure it was yellow and not goldenrod or Egyptian sand? I take my colors very damn seriously.
Yes, yes, yes! Let's sink it, let's sink it, let's! There's no one more nasty than you! Yeah, yeah, yeah! We'll sink it and no one will know!
If you're still alive after that, the sharks proceed to, you guessed it, sink the sub. The sub crashes into the bottom of the ocean and knocks everybody unconscious. Meanwhile, Razor Teeth gets a little dental work done, and has the animal send a telegram to their human ally, the Baron. So they connect a network of jellyfish to a bunch of clams like a large keyboard, and this somehow fully functions. Alright, who smoked one? Meanwhile, back at the wreck, Tentacles returns to find his friends unconscious, and tries to free them, but he just can't seem to lift the sub. Now wait a minute, you're telling me that he can throw massive icebergs at the Titanic, but he can't pull a small round piece of metal out from the rocks? I guess consistency is another obsolete thing to these filmmakers right next to historic accuracy. Speaking of which, a group of Atlantean guards arrive to lend Tentacles a hand. Oh wait, I've been calling him the wrong name this entire time.
Oh, stop that, Adi! What you're doing is useless!
Really? So, a film that's named after one of the most standout characters has his name changed to something that's completely forgettable. Okay, I'll tell you, his name is Adi, and wait 5 seconds? And you've already forgotten!
Anyways, Tentacles, yeah, that's what I'm calling him, opens the hatch so the guards can give Don Juan and the others safe passage to Atlantis. Sadly, not the resort, even though that would make for a much better film.
I swear, if something bad happens to my friends, I'll rip every tooth out of that shark and I'll make them into the most beautiful necklace you've ever seen!
That's gotta be the friendliest threat I've ever heard.
I'll rip every tooth out of that shark and I'll make them into the most beautiful necklace you've ever seen!
After I tear his eyes from their sockets, coat them in shellac, and make them into a lovely pair of matching earrings!
While you're wondering how a vacuum of water didn't flood the inside of the sub after he opened it, Don, Elizabeth, and the others are carried back to Atlantis. And I have to admit, I've never seen a location so squandered of all its potential before. In all seriousness, there is little that is explained. We see their technology in a few locations, but there is never a time where you get to enjoy the atmosphere. If the filmmakers didn't care at all about the film, what was the point to begin with? So everyone is excited about the new residents, and they inform the king, and this is where we meet our nightmares. Like, why is that dolphin red? How did the Rockbiter's deformed baby get here? Why does this Daxter wannabe have fins? Why does this fish have a spring for a penis? What the hell am I looking at?! The king, who honestly looks the most threatening, decides that the newcomers will have to permanently live in Atlantis after they drink this sort of elixir that allows them to breathe underwater. And he also promotes Fish Stick over here to the rank of ambassador.
Your Highness, if you carry on encouraging him like this, Pimgol will become so vain he'll end up being totally unbearable.
Too late.
So Elizabeth, Don Juan, Smile, and the mice drink the elixir. Yeah, no questions asked.
Of course. Keep calm. If they wanted to harm us, they wouldn't have saved us. And this elixir is such a pretty color. Come on, drink.
Antifreeze is also a pretty color.
So we get some phoned-in shots that I guess are supposed to be charming and whimsical, while the gang's on their way to meet the springfish, whose name is Pingo, by the way.
Huh? I don't believe it. Aren't those toys?
Yes, they are. You have no idea how many toys we have rescued. Toys that have gone overboard during their crossing. Toys trapped in wrecks down here.
Oh, but... hey, look at that! They talk and move just like us!
And that surprises you? The king says everything lives, moves, and thinks, even if it seems impossible at times.
So, wait. When did this become the island of misfit toys? And what's the point of it? It's only adding more holes to the cluttered mess that is this plot. So just as our heroes, yeah, I say that very loosely, start to get a little suspicious, Pingo begins with the biggest disaster I've ever seen. A sloppy musical number.
Welcome to Atlantis, where everything's a dream. And it's a special place. We have a king and have a queen. Here is a surprise. You can thank your lucky stars that I have saved your lives.
Is fresh, you can swim around at the fish hotel. It's a real cool sound. Coming to my shelf, a dozen custard dime. Every single day, it's always party time. Bubble, bubble, toilet trouble, don't mean a thing. We can sip all day while the dolphins sing.
Oh my god. This is really all over the place, and it tries to combine two different genres. It's like listening to Nirvana and then having it suddenly change to Luke Bryan. It just doesn't segue.
Coming to my shelf, I dozen custard time. Every single day, it's always party time.
I'll just spare you the agony and move right along.
And now, I hope you will accept my apologies and those of the Queen for the lack of tact displayed by our counselor when he gave you the news.
Well, at least he had the decency to apologize for that train wreck. The way that this is set up makes it seem almost threatening. I mean, they did save their lives, but then all of a sudden they're just like, "You will live here forever, and you can never return home. Welcome to society, bitches. Now get to work. We don't like dead weight.